the panel of methods that you can take to solve the problem directly. First, maybe, is there any question about the first part that you want to discuss again? No question during the lunch break, so just no. So when we go with the direct resolution, so again, the direct resolution will be to approximate the optimal control problem into a static optimization problem that we can solve with classical optimization framework. And again, there is really these two aspects, the approximation into a static optimization problem and the resolution, they are two very different parts. They are coupled, the choice that you are making on one are impacting the choice that you are making on the second, but it's very, very important to keep in mind that they are very different and they should be as decoupled as possible. So the first part, we call that the transcription. You have an optimal control problem, or an OCP for short, and you transcript that into a non-linear problem, NLP for short, with constraints. Okay. And there is many choices that you can do here. I will quickly go through them. At the end, you have an NLP, and you can give that to a black box optimization problem. In general, any transcription that you will do, you will end up with something that is non-linear, that is sparse, and that has constraints. That's stuff that you will, whatever the transcription you are doing, it's very uncommon if you don't have all these properties together. And then, we are using a solver to solve this optimal control problem, this NLP problem that you get by the transcription. I would say that in general, NLP theory apply very well to the static optimization problem that we get. So the transcription is what is making direct optimization, direct optimal control very specific. The resolution is not so specific. That's a very hard optimization problem because it's nonlinear, it's sparse, and it has constraints. So we are really at the cutting edge of what we are able to do with optimization solver. So that's why guys in optimal control theory, they spend some time in developing their own solver. It's not really much that they are participating to the development of NLP solver. It's rather that they don't find on the market a black box solver that is satisfying all their needs. And that's also a problem that we have in the project, that we are able to nicely write, transcribe the problem, and we have many choices and we are strong with that. And then solving it, it's still something that is weak in the literature. So, I think the easiest way to understand the transcription is to say, instead of trajectory of time and trajectory of control, I will make a stack, a sequence of samples control and samples state. And then the integral becomes just a sum at every point where you have a sample. Okay. And then the differential equation just becomes something like from my current state and my current control, predict me what would be the next state, in something like a millisecond or 10 milliseconds. That's really the easiest way to understand transcription. And in fact, it's not so far from being generic. So if you really want to make that generic, well, when you do X and U to be points, a sample along the timeline, in fact, what you are doing is that you are representing your trajectory by piecewise constant element. Okay? So it's not really that you are sampling, because what you are representing is always a trajectory. So saying, I just have samples, it's not a trajectory anymore. What is exactly that is piecewise constant element. Say, I'm constant in x, and then I'm jumping, constant in x again, and I'm jumping. And it's an approximation, right? We said in the beginning it's an approximation. So when you do that, you have zero order polynomials, and just to make that generic, you say instead of piecewise constant, you make piecewise velocity constant, piecewise acceleration constant, piecewise jump constant, whatever you want. And then this discretization becomes a polynomial discretization, that's the most generic. Any polynomial basis that you want is possible to investigate. And then there is a result in the field of what is the good polynomial basis that you need to use. I think that in the context of memo and in the context of having something running on the robot, we don't need to investigate that so much. So currently in Crocodile, we only have piecewise constant, and I think it's enough. Maybe we can go for something else. Oh.
You have piecewise constants, parts of the state, no? Because other parts are the integrals of this. So
when you write a problem like that, it's exactly what you are doing. you say my x is constant piecewise, my u is constant piecewise.
No, but if some x is the derivative of some other one, and this other one is constant, the first one should not be constant.
You don't have them anymore. It's zero. You have approximated this derivative by something that is a step.
But
we will go a little bit more in detail. Okay. So it's an approximation. Okay. So now, if you want to visualize, I think it's best to visualize with polynomials. So now we have a polynomial in x and a polynomial in u. And for some nodes, some points in time interval, you are saying my dynamics should fit. Okay? For the other, I cannot check. So I would just check at some point. And then, voila, I have polynomials that are crossing like that at the point where they are attached. And otherwise, they are doing something else. If you are checking often enough, then you are very close to satisfy the dynamics. In fact, what this is meaning is that the information in x and u are somehow redundant. If you know u, you can integrate and get x. If you know x, well, somehow you maybe can guess u at some point. And they are redundant also, they are impossible to completely match. So typically, if you take a pendulum and you put a piecewise polynomial control, then you don't get a piecewise polynomial state. You get something else. There is an exponential in that. So if you try to represent the state with the polynomials, well, you would make an approximation. So you are making a mistake in the model. Well, it's not important because it's not a mistake in the problem that you are formulating. It's just that this model will not exactly match the model. So again, when you transcript, you approximate. And we all know that, and it's fair. So let's see now how we transcript. What are the details in the transcription? So first, I would like to go in this redundant aspect. So one of the big aspects of the transcription is that you end up with a very, very large static optimization problem. So if you take a human robot, for example, you have something like, roughly speaking, 50 degrees of freedom. And so your state is 50 configuration and 50 velocity, so 100. And you want to optimize for 100 time step in the future. So that's 100 times 100 variables. That's the total number of variables you need to optimize. So 10,000 variables. And we are targeting 1 millisecond resolution. That's the control cycle of the robot. We want to do predictive control. So if possible, we would like to solve that in 1 millisecond. And that's not matching. 10,000 variables, 1 millisecond of computation time is not possible. So cutting in the computation time would be important. And one very naive and interesting way of cutting the computation time is to cut in the number of variables. So there is two, we say x and u are redundant. If you have x, you can get u. If you have u, you can get x. So let's remove one of them. So I think the first intuitive way of seeing optimal control, so that is trajectory optimization. I'm most interested by my state because that's where I write the objectives. Like I want the robot to stand, I want the robot to grasp an object, this kind of stuff. So it's best to write my objective in terms of states. So let's keep the state variable. Then I don't have the constraint that is constraining x and u to match together. Instead, I have to guess what is u knowing my state. So this is basically something like inverse dynamics. You know one point, just the next point. So basically, you know the acceleration, and you can guess the forces that have been applied. And if you are lucky enough, this map is not too difficult to compute or too difficult to approximate. Okay. So this view of optimal control is a view from calculus variation. So you optimize a smooth object, which is a trajectory over time, and there is constraint on this trajectory. And that's the same way you optimize the shape of the wing of an airplane. You have a smooth object, and you put a curve on it, and you optimize the curve. And in fact, it's not a very good view of optimal control. There is a lot of constraints that you can write on the control and that are very difficult to write on the state. So typically, non-holomic constraints, so constraints that you have on a car, that you have on the unicycle cannot move on the side, that's very difficult to describe on the state. It's super easy to describe on the control, but on the state, it's difficult. Similarly, there is many cases where this map is not invertible. That's the case for the leg robot. If you look at me, I have my 2 feet in contact with the ground. Just looking at my movement, you cannot guess what are the forces that I am applying on the ground. maybe my muscles are relaxed and I'm just applying normal forces, or maybe I am pushing to try to exert lateral forces. But they are not out of the friction cone, so there is no motion. You cannot guess there is forces. So inverting that is not possible. So one way, since we cannot invert, is to make a rough approximation of it that is invertible, and then iteratively during the resolution, turn to something that is really the exact match. So that's what they do in this paper that is very famous and very impressive. Well, basically, they work on the state and not on the control, and they are trying to guess the state by inverse dynamics. And since it is not invertible, in the beginning, they are injecting something that is not physically meaningful. They call that magic forces, so they allow the system to fly in the beginning. And then during the search, more and more, they decrease the possibility to use magic forces, until at the end, the system is using only very, very little of the magic forces, and it's very close to be a physically meaningful movement. So this, the very first way, having X and U, you call that collocation. Because I think that's the reason why we name it like this, we collocalize constraints in a dynamic constraints for each point where you have an integration. Then the second one is trajectory optimization. You really work on the X, not on the U. You try to optimize the state trajectory. I tend to name that explicit because it's explicit in X. The third formulation is to say, well, I can get X if I just integrate U. So we say roll out U, we have a simulator. You know the initial state, you know the sequence of control. You give that to the simulator and it will give you the trajectory. So X can be directly written as a function of the initial state and all the control sequence. So that's called a shooting formulation. I tend to say that it is implicit in X. You don't have the X decision variable anymore. It's super, super simple to implement. You just have to have a simulator and to be able somehow to take the derivative of the simulator. And then you have an unconstrained optimization problem. Okay? That's not a constraint anymore, right? It's just that any time I have an X here and there, I will copy this function of U. Okay? So then I have a big function of U here and a big function of U here. Okay? So everything is a function of U. I don't have any constraint anymore, and I just take the derivative of the simulator, and that's fine. Chain rule, with difference, the different derivative of that would be the derivative of that times the derivative of the simulator. Then it's easy to implement because it's not going through a constraint optimization. The big drawback of that is that numerically this is very unstable. It means the relation between the first control variable and the objective, and between the last control variable and the objective, are very improperly scaled. If you did a mistake in the very beginning of the control, it's very likely that at the end you fall. And there is nothing you can do with your last variable to correct that. Okay? So then there is something that is unfair in the share of leadership between the variable in the beginning of the horizon and in the end of the horizon. Mathematically, it means that when you will take the derivative of that, the eigenvalues corresponding to the first control would be super big, and the eigenvalue corresponding to the last control would be super small. And that's very, very bad for numerical solvers. So it means that the numerical solvers will really fight with this ill conditioning and will tend to go in bad local minima. So this kind of solver, they are easy to implement, and they are easy to make fast, but then they are stupid. And basically, there is nothing you can do against the fact that they are stupid, except changing the transcription. Okay. So far, so good.
So when you said eigenvalue, you mean the of Hessian?
Yes. Yes.
With respect to the first
yes.
control.
Yes.
You have to move a lot.
Yeah.
It's up more.
Maybe in terms of, so that's the numerical interpretation, so maybe that's the best for you. Another interpretation is to say that the cost landscape is shaped to be on some direction, falling very, very quickly, like you are on an edge of a mountain that is very sharp, and the edge is not straight. So each time you are making a motion toward an objective that is very far away on the edge, you are taking a straight line and you are falling. And so you can only make very small steps on the edge, otherwise you are always falling. So the solver spends all his time falling on the very steep cliffs, and he cannot do big steps. Okay, that's the geometrical interpretation of the stronger, the bad eigenvalues.
The dimensions of that are every u at every time step.
Yes. So here the control variable is a stack of all the u's. Mm-hmm. So we say something like, I don't know, 100 here, and you have 100 of them mm-hmm. here. So in total, 10,000. So when I'm saying of a cliff and a edge, it is in dimension 10,000.
Yeah.
You have to visualize a mountain in 10,000 inches. Mm-hmm. Is there questions or remarks? Shooting, so it's called shooting problem. It's coming from war, so from optimizing rockets. So in rockets, it's a little bit the same problem. You don't have all the U's, right? You just have the very, very first one. But you have the same problem of ill conditioning at the end of the cycle. And then that's the rocket probe. I have this example. So DDP is very old. It's like, was very famous in the 80s. Any researcher in control theory will tell you that it's a very crappy solution. It became popular again in robotics in 2010, a lot with the work of Emo Todorov. So that's the work of Emo Todorov, applied on the HRP robot. And the work of Emo Todorov was a lot about, I have a nice formulation of the problem, a nice simulator, and I want to use that to do optimal control. Let's implement something quick, and DDP is good for that. But then everybody started to look at the work of Emo Todorov, say, wow, we can do that, it's great, and went a lot in DDP. And nowadays, we found a lot of paper about DDP that I think should not exist. They are doing something very, very complex with DDP. Well, DDP is something meant to be simple. So this example is here to show that it's fast. So here it's running real time. We are moving the ball with the 3D mouse. And it's stupid. You can see that the robot is barely able to find a step. So when the ball is too far, it's not able to step towards the ball. And yeah, the solver cannot find that. It's not in the range of... he's not able to find this nice optimum where he will make a step. He's staying in the local optimum where he's not making a step. In the project, I believe that this technology is enough because we should have stored in the memory that we can make a step. So it's not necessary to expect the solver will find that. In any case, I don't think that in real time we have time to find that. So let's just have that stored in the memory, and that would be good to refine it in real time on the robot. Just to show that. You can so it's generic because the simulator is generic, so we can work on the non-flat floor. So that's not solver dependent. It's the physics that you are using, and the arrow are the forces that we are applying to the system to disturb it. And here the light is not very good, but the foot are not flat anymore on the floor because the solver is not smart enough. Discover that putting the foot flat on the floor is a good point. Right? We have to tweak again a cost to tell him that. And then finally, he falls because he's not using this capability of putting the foot flat on the floor. And he also that in a research paper, you can show bad fall like that. It's appreciated. So that was for the single shooting. Discuss a little bit again, just to say, well, we are not blind. We are doing, in Crocodile, we implemented shooting problem. We know that it's weak, but there is many advantages. So there is a trade-off, and we are selecting it for reasons. An alternative to multiple shooting is very well known. It's called multiple shooting. So multiple shooting, I think, is interesting to explain it with the rocket example, which was introduced for that. So say you have a rocket, and you want to control that. And for a rocket, the visible space is very, very small. If you do some mistake with your control, and basically the rocket will diverge. And well, in practice it will explode. But in theory, when you integrate in the simulator, what you get is at the end of this first trajectory, because you diverge, you explode the simulator and you get a not a number. Okay? So at the end, the cost of this trajectory is not a number. Now you tweak a little bit the control, that's what the optimizer is doing, right? It's changing a little bit the control. And you integrate again, and you get something better. Look, it is better, it's exploding further. And the solution to that is not a number. So the first trajectory, the cost is not a number, the second one is not a number. The solver cannot compare these two trajectories. And that's because the problem is ill-conditioned. So that's the result of the ill-conditioning. And if it's not a if you are strong enough to not get not a number, you add used values with a lot of sensibilities, and it's just the same. So comparing these two bad trajectories is very difficult for the solver. So what the guys in multiple shooting did is to say, instead of rolling out, of simulating a single trajectory, we will just simulate a trajectory for a few amount of time. So say a tenth or a hundredth of the complete trajectory. And then we teleport the system to anywhere he wants. So I introduce a new decision variable here, and I can start rolling out from this new point. Okay? So I integrate a little bit, teleport. Integrate a little bit, teleport. And that way, the rocket will never explode, because each time, since you have a teleportation, you will teleport, the solver will teleport the system to a point that is convenient for the task. So we'll, basically, it will stay in the column where the rocket can survive. And then, in addition to this new variable that you put, well, you put constraints. You say that this should be continuous, so the gap should be zero. Okay, so we should not use the teleportation. So it's a little bit the same trick than the magic forces I mentioned for the work of Mordach. You are introducing a new variable, and this new variable is helping your system to work better, and your solver to discover something better. Okay. In general, we call this way of introducing new variable lifting. We say here we lifted the shooting problem into a multiple shooting problem. So we added variables. So it's a little bit counterintuitive. In the beginning, we said reducing the number of variables reduces the complexity. But in fact, here, increasing a little bit the number of variables makes the solver much more efficient. That's called multiple shooting.
What do you mean here by OU and some X?
So the decision variables, good question. The decision variables that you are using is you have use at every time step. Well, so typically you are discretizing or you are playing polynomials, and you are modeling all of them in the transcription.
Oh, yeah, okay.
But you are not modeling the X's. The X's will be obtained by integration, except some few X's where you are teleporting the system.
So X is not at every time step.
No.
Only at
so typically for I don't know, for locomotion problem, for making a step like that, you will put 10 X's, so we call that shooting nodes, and you will put a control at every millisecond. Mm-hmm. So then, for 1 second of movement, you would have 1,000 control and 10 states. Okay. So the states are here just to leave the problem and to make it numerically sustainable. Other questions?
I was just a question about the resultive integration. So how does it work? So it starts integrating each piece separately.
Yes.
And then it applies the continuity constraints that tells that the nodes should match.
Yes.
But it restarts integration.
So I did not try to
integrate every shot individually. So you integrate one trajectory independently of the other one you roll out. And then you have link constraints that you have to put this back. These two trajectories.
But this will reinitiate another integration at the time at each, let's say, optimization step.
So in the shooting problem, we integrate always from x0. Okay? Mm-hmm. And any new control, we integrate a little bit further. Here, and we have absolutely no x. Here we say x of t. It will be computed with a simulation that is depending from the last shooting node, and not from the beginning of the interval. And the last shooting node is there. And then in addition, we say that x at the end of a shooting interval, so an interval where you integrate, should be the same as the decision variable x. Yeah, so you have these two values. Yeah. Clear on like that?
Yeah.
But then, so the solver is iterating, and at each iteration needs to restart the iteration of each of the pieces.
Each of the pieces, yes.
Taking into account the current x
yes.
at the start of each piece.
Okay.
Which is a decision variable again.
Yeah. We have in IMU integration, we have something called the free integration. I don't know if you
yeah.
use this. That you linearize the position at the end of the segment with respect to the state at the beginning.
Yeah, so it's done for something very, very different. In the case of the state estimation, you are doing that because you have too many measurements mm-hmm. and you want to get rid of the ones that are not informative. Here it's that it's diverging and you want to avoid the big divergence.
So you will be far away, actually, as
yes.
a problem with the...
Well, typically, the dynamics, they are unstable, so there is an exponential somewhere. And
yeah.
at some point, the exponential becomes too big, start to be too big, so you reset it.
I'm choosing these intervals, that shooting intervals. Is there any practical consideration when choosing the intervals?
Many. And for that, I'm not the best expert. So in the project, we have a scientific advisory board. And in the scientific advisory board, we have Moritz Diehl.
Can we reach that?
At least for the student of the project, I believe that if you want to have advice from Moritz Diehl, you would be welcome. Well, you're not in the project, but Moritz Diehl is a very friendly person. So.
But typically, you need to analyze the stiffness of your equation, the differential equation.
Okay.
That's what typically I know people for optimal control does. So it's like metric, but I think you can have an idea.
Okay.
But there is also a lot of like tuning.
And in practice, there is a lot of change.
Thank
you. Yes, this is a strong field. There is some strong research on that field. And the framework they are quite difficult to develop, understand. That is a whole domain. Maybe we should do that. Okay, so I don't have a summary slide for all that. But basically, you have all these transcriptions that are possible. Collocation and shooting are the two that are easy to implement. Shooting is the one that is the easiest to implement. They are not everything. The way you are modeling your problems, the way you are computing the equation, the integration, the derivative of all that is very, very important. And I think maybe it's a key component when we want to scale to a whole body control. Here, clearly, the scaling is one of the big issues. They are strong in multiple shooting for controlling stuff like a car, a kite, a chemical factory, this kind of stuff that are not too big in dimension and not too fast in dynamics. So they have time to control it, and even the size of the system at the end is not too big. And you saw the unicycle this morning. Any Python implementation, that's working. It will give you a solution quickly. Now we want to scale both in dimension. We want to go to 100 in terms of dimension, 10,000 variables, and in terms of speed of resolution. 1 millisecond is not reasonable, but 10 milliseconds maybe it is. 100, we need to go below 100, that's for sure. If we don't, we cannot have that on the robot. And this scaling, I think it's guiding us to say, well, let's start with a method of the state of the art that are not too difficult to implement. Because we are also already fighting with so many constraints. The size, the computation of the dynamics, obstacles that are crazy, constraints that you want to take into account, all that. So if we put in addition the fact that we need to develop a multiple shooting solver, it's too much. So I think going with the DDP is a good way to go.
So now that you mentioned Moritz Diehl, his group develops also many solvers.
Yes.
So why are they not sufficient for...
It's a good question. When you write and transcribe the problem, there is not enough automation in that. So the methods are not automatic enough. Like when you want to decide if you may put a shooting node or not, well, that's something we don't know. We have some theoretical results, but in practice, you tune. And when you scale up, it starts to be way too much difficult to tune it. So So the solver becomes not to be reliable enough, they crash all the time, the way they handle memory management. So there is a lot of technology limits, and also a lot of collision with the way you model the system. So I say you should keep the modelization of the transcription independent from the resolution, and in practice we are not at a level where we can do that. So we roboticists, we have to understand both. We are strong with the transcription, with the modeling, and not so strong with the optimization. Guys that are very strong with optimization, they don't understand enough of the model that we have in robotics. They consider the robot to be one dynamical system among others, and in fact it's not true. It's a dynamical system that is much more complex. That's why we don't have robots that are working, and we have cars that are. Because the control problem is really different and very, very much, much more complex. So I think we need to have a little bit more understanding of the resolution part, and for that going with a simple solver is, I think, which in CNRS we try to go with complex solver during 5 years, and we think that it is time now that we develop our own solver, and that's the only way to scale.
So the summary is, if we use an easy solver, then at least we know why it breaks.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, basically.
We have trying also Musco, and sometimes struggling with Musco.
One of the strongest solver for optimal control for multiple shooting is called Muscode, and it killed a bunch of students. Strong students. Other questions? So that was for the transcription. I go for the resolution. I'm even less an expert, but basically, you have two classes of NLP approaches, so approaches to solve nonlinear problems with constraints. And basically, the first one is called sequential quadratic programming, is to say I have two problems. I have something that is nonlinear and that is under constraints. I would first approximate the nonlinear aspect of the difficulty. So I will make the system linear, but I keep the constraints. Now I work with a linear system under constraints. I make an improvement computed from the linear system under constraints. And then, iteratively, when I go further in the search, I relinear the system. Okay? So that's one approach to do. Alternatively, you can rather say, I have, again, the constraint and the non-linearity. I will keep the non-linearity, but I will remove the constraint. So now I work with a system, a problem that is non-linear, but that has no constraint anymore. And iteratively, I will change my problem so that it converges to the problem that is non-linear under constraint. So that's two very different ways of seeing the problem. Keeping the constraints and working with something that is linear and changing it iteratively, or keeping the non-linearity and removing the constraints and changing that iteratively. So that's sequential quadratic programming, and that's typically augmented Lagrangian in this class also. So, DDP, and so what we implemented in Crocodile, and what you have also in multiple shooting, and well, many solvers for optimal control are SQP. So let's try to explain it a little bit better. There is a drawing on my slide. Apparently it's in blue, that is too light and you cannot see it. I'm colorblind, so maybe I missed something, but I don't think you see any level set here, right?
No.
So here there is a level set displaying the cost function. So this picture is to display what is the geometry of a simple NLP problem. So that would be the constraint. So you are searching for a solution that is on this curve. So that's representing a constraint. You see the constraint is nonlinear. And somewhere here, so that's all the space where your cost is defined. So you have a level set and there is an optimal. So typically, there is a global optimum here without the constraints, and then you know the circles are growing like that, like circle in the water, and you are trying to get the best of this level set on this curve. What OSQP will do is typically we'll start with a solution that is not feasible, that is there. So you give it a guess, typically a sequence of zero, that is not satisfying your constraints. So, for example, if you take a pendulum problem, you are telling a solution where the pendulum is like that, and is not moving, and there is no control. Okay? Physically, it has no sense. That's what you are giving to the system. feasible SQP, what he will do is first he will try to project this on the constraint. We will try to find a feasible guess. So say the projection arrives here. And then at every step, you will linearize the constraints. We also linearize the cost. And it will go along this linearized constraint. And what you can immediately see is that when you go along the linearized constraint, you are going away of the constraints. So you cannot make a step that is too big, because you have to make a trade-off between how close you stay to the constraints and how well you improve your cost. Okay? And this trade-off is done with what we call a merit function that is exactly encoding that. It's generally a function that is very heuristic and that you have to understand well, because you will have to tweak it. And typically for multiple shooting, the merit function will decide sometimes to relax the shooting constraints and sometimes to relax other constraints. And it's doing that smartly so that it converges well. If it's not exactly cranked up for your problem, well, it's not working well and you are not happy and there is nothing you can do. Tuning this merit function is something that is very difficult. And also you can see that maybe the projection, instead of going there in the beginning, it will project there. That's very, very possible. So it's very likely that whatever the guess you give in the beginning, if it's not possible, the projection will be bad. And it will bring the system very, very far from something that is acceptable. And then the convergence to something that is acceptable would take a lot of time. And it's difficult to understand that in terms of geometry, because you gave an initial guess that, yes, it's not feasible, but in terms of cost, it's not too far from the cost that you want. But the projection to the feasible set, it will kill your solution. And then the solver will never be able to recover that again. So this kind of stuff, because it's non-convex, as Steve this morning said, he does not like non-convex problems. He's right, non-convex problems are awful to handle. So if you don't like that, you can go work with Steve about trying to be smart to reformulate this problem as a simpler and a convex problem. So that's really a gross introduction about optimization. I strongly encourage anybody to read the Nocedal book or the Boyd book. There is a fight. Speak with Andrea if you want to have arguments for Boyd. Speak with me for arguments for Nocedal. I think it's really, for many problems of learning, optimization, fitting, it's really helping to read this book and understand better what are the stakes behind developing these tools. Is there any questions? We are nearly done for the theoretical part.
Maybe a perspective question. So you argue that in robotics we need to start writing our own MMP solver because using off-the-shelf solvers doesn't seem to work. And I think you first pulled out these arguments a couple of years ago when I was still at LAS, and I was quite against this option because my argument was
lot of work.
In robotics we are not strong enough to write our own NLP solvers. That's the job of people working in numerical optimization, so we should not pretend to be good enough for that. We should just maybe go and search for this expertise somewhere else. So now it's been 2 years that the idea of writing
NLP
solver inside robotics group has started. And as far as I know, despite the rumors I heard, the solver is not ready yet. So it seems that the project was actually really challenging.
So I think one way you would agree is to say we have to stop not talking to the guys that are developing the solvers and expecting them to provide solvers that are fitting our need. So we need to work more with them, understand what they are doing. And for that, I think building small prototypes is a good way. And in that sense, I think developing a TDP is a good aspect. So it's not competing, for example, with Moritz Deal. It's much simpler. And it's a way to say, well, look, we met this problem that I think you never met before. And we have some solutions. So maybe now do the job of putting this solution if you're nice over in your nice black box that I will be able to use later. I think we should do that. then people in, for example, in optimization, they are not so strong as us. So we can compete with them. It's a choice that we don't do it. So we can contribute. I'm not saying we should, but at least we can. And then, clearly developing what Andrea is mentioning is we are trying to develop a generic sparse augmented Lagrangian solver in the lab. And that's 2 years we started that, and it did not move a lot. And yeah, so that's correct. So this part was pretty much a failure. I agree with that.
I mean, maybe it's just bad management, meaning that people who were supposed to work on that didn't work on that. Or maybe it was really hard, and that's why it hasn't progressed much. But I don't know, because I'm no longer in the lab, so I was just curious.
So it's a lot of problem of management. People that should focus on that are not focusing on that. It's also that it's a hard problem, so it's difficult to focus on that because it's quickly boring. And also it's very difficult to get people that are good enough to go in that. So you want them to understand, they came for robotics, but they have to be strong enough, both in mathematics and in computer science, to develop their own solver and compete with a big head there. So clearly if you had 10 people that are likely to work with a solver, the management become less an issue. If you have only one or two and they are not really wanting to work on it, you are doomed. But yes, it's a very difficult problem. The idea also of going to augmented Lagrangian was to say SQPs are too complex for robotics, not only for us, but only for black box. No SQP solver can tackle the problem that we have in robotics in a reliable manner. So basically, a SQP solver cannot be reliable. We cannot put that on board the robot. So we have to find another solution. And the trend is to enter points that are very difficult to adapt to robotics. They are very difficult to warm start. So trying to go to augmented Lagrangian and know better who is in the augmented Lagrangian domain and what could we do to boost a little bit this field, was successful. We get to know some people that are developing augmented Lagrangian solver. We understand a little bit better the stake in augmented Lagrangian. Now we can say why we are using SQP. Why it's not so easy to write an augmented. So here in Crocodile, as I said, we spend a lot on the transcription and very, very little on the resolution. So the DDP is 10% of the complete framework. And I think that's important. So I guess we could think of removing the DDP and putting IP ops instead, if we like it. So the code is written for that.
Interpoint
method, but
not good for one point.
Yeah. Any other question about the remark of Andrea?
So when you say augmented Lagrangian,
yes.
Do you refer to things like ADMM?
No, so ADMM is one method that is built on top of augmented Lagrangian. Augmented Lagrangian is a way of, so I think before just answering to augmented Lagrangian, there is penalty solver.
Okay.
Basically, penalty solver, what he will do is instead of having a cost under a constraint, he will have a cost plus 10 times the constraint. Then you solve that. Then you say, okay, now I take the solution and I optimize the cost plus 100 times the constraint. And you crank up the cost term, the constraint term, until finally you get something that is you are happy enough with that. The augmented Lagrangian is doing that plus the Lagrangian machine. That's what we try to do. Okay, so SQPs, what they are doing is, as I said, they are taking the nonlinear system with constraints and they are copying to approximating to a linear system with constraints. So a linear system with constraints will look something like that. The constraint will be instead of x is equal to f of x u, it will be the linear version of it. X is equal to fx of x times fu of u, where fx and fu stand for the partial derivative of x with respect to x and u. And for the cost, we take the quadratic approximation, so it could look like something like that. So instead of plain cost, we have quadratic terms in the cost. And that's basically the equation for the linear quadratic regulator, LQR, which is a very classical object in a control cell. So basically, SQP, that what they will do is that at each iteration of the solver, they will more or less compute the LQR, solve the LQR, and change a little bit the solution to better fit to the LQR. Change the trajectory, relinearize the system, recompute the new LQR solution, change again. Okay? So in that sense, we can call them iterative LQR. Iterative LQR is the name that Todorov introduced when he reinvented this method based on the work of Main, that Main called that differential dynamic programming. Differential dynamic programming is a little bit the same meaning, saying that I will apply LQR and dynamic programming to a system that is linear, that is the differentiation of my non-linear system. Okay? So both names, in fact, have there is a Greek etymology and the Latin etymology, often in French, and that's a little bit the same. There is the Bellman etymology and the control etymology.
And is it correct to say that this one iteration is has an analytical solution? So to solve for this,
yes,
you have a formula.
You have a formula, yeah. So generally, it's an algorithmic formula, but you have an exact resolution to this.
For the linear system, the Riccati equation. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So if you have a t time step in t iteration backward and t iteration forward, you get the exact solution. So yes, we know to solve that efficiently. So just to give a little bit more, here is the system when I just put the terms in space. So I have the sum of my L, so I put them in a, I change off line at each sum, so it's a sum that you have to read like that. And for the control, I do the same, but I put a tabulation each time. See, so there is a structure that appears when you are doing that. So on this column, you have only x zeros. On this column, only u zeros. Then now x1, then u1. You see it? So there is this structure that appears for each column of my board. I have only one variable that appears in that. And this will be copied when you will differentiate your system. So when you take the derivative of the constraints, well, the first derivative, the derivative of the first row will only correspond to the derivative of the first variable. On the second row, you will have the derivative of the two first variables plus the identity for the last variable, etc. So the Jacobian will be bound diagonal like that by block. And for the cost, well, it's better to look at the Hessian, so you differentiate twice, and you will have a square matrix. And on the first block, you have only x0 and u0 terms. And same for the second one. So the Hessian will be block diagonal. So in final, the shape, if we remove the writing, would be like that. The Jacobian would be an identity matrix on the diagonal, and then blocks under the diagonals. And the Hessian will be only blocks. Okay? So in all that, you have t times n variables. So you have t times n squared, so t squared n squared possible numbers in this board, but you only have t blocks. So in total, not t squared n squared, but t n squared non-zeros. So it's really much lower number of zeros, of non-zeros. And the final matrix that you will tackle is what we call the KKT matrix. So maybe that's expert level, and that's the final size, so if you don't understand that, just take a break. The KKT matrix is the Hessian, the Jacobian transpose, Jacobian zero. And the shape of the KKT will be like that. So I reordered. I think the shape is nicer when you put all the x first and all the u second. Then I still have my diagonal of zero, the x blocks below. Diagonal of zero here, the u blocks below. And then in the state, well, that's the x derivatives, that's the u derivatives, that's the xu derivative, and the ux derivatives. And typically, we have a strong cost on the x, so the block diagonal on the x part will be complex. Most of the time, we have a regularization cost on the u, so very likely it's an identity diagonal or something that looks very much like the identity diagonal. And well, diagonal again. So it has a very, very strong shape. And one of the stakes when computing the solution would be to invert that quickly. It's one of the big parts of the computation cost. And if you invert with everything dense, you will kill the performance of your system. So here, any sparse solver is welcome. And DDP is one particular sparse solver that will use the Riccati regression to compute a nice solution out of that. Okay? And we see a lot of papers about DDP. And in fact, it's only said what DDP is doing is just said in this sentence. It's one particular sparse solver using the Riccati regression to solve the inverse of this matrix. So sometimes you are reading 10 or 20 pages of DDP papers for just a sparse solver doing that, which is very interesting in practice. Okay. So why are we doing that? Well, because a sparse solver is super boring to implement, while the Riccati regression is very, very easy, like it's 10 lines of code. So DDP is a very cheap to implement solution to implement a very efficient sparse solver, and we are very happy with that. In crocodiles, it corresponds to that amount of code. And just to keep some numbers in mind, for crocodile, we don't have them yet because that's not C++. We have them for Mujoko because I work with Emo Todorov. On Mujoko, there is two big parts of the time budget when you are computing the control law. One is to compute the derivative, so form this matrix, fill the blocks. And that's very expensive because on Mujoko it's done by finite differencing, which is very an efficient way of computing the derivatives. And the other one is to solve this matrix, to invert it. So inverting a matrix parallel is difficult. So implement that on several cores is, first it's difficult, and second it's quickly inefficient because it's not, so the time you spend in communicating between the cores takes a lot of time with respect to solving the problem itself. Computing the finite differencing, that's very easy to parallelize. So they parallelize the finite differencing and not the inversion. And in total, 80% of the time budget is spent on the derivatives and 10% on the inversion. Okay? So inversion is really a small amount of the budget. Plus, the derivative is run on 30 cores of computation. So in fact, 97% of the total cost budget is on the derivatives, not on the inversion. And again, that's against DDP, right? We are doing nice papers about DDP. The resolution itself in robotics is nothing. What is difficult is the formulation. So crocodile is about the formulation, not about the resolution.
So, why don't we use the solver of Emo Todorov? So just the solving part. Since we have the derivatives with Pinocchio,
yeah.
Is there an open source implementation or is he selling it?
Yes, so there is an implementation by Yuval in Plain C that is somewhere on the web that we can use.
Okay.
It's 100 lines of code, so we can use.
It's a dumb solver. So it's
yes.
Okay.
You give matrices and you solve it.
By the way,
we can use that definitely.
Mujoko uses the Mujoko engine, so the way that they are doing stuff with, you can see the Emo Todorov paper. So they have this relaxation of the Gaussian problem principle. We don't know if that is going to work in a real robot, in legged robot.
No, but he was speaking of the solver.
The solver.
Yuval solver is independent of Mujoko and is available. So here is for the yeah.
Can you quite disappointed to that? Because I think I've been looking for that. I found one by him, but that was so written with Mujoko variables that.
Okay, I think I can. The GitHub of Yuval is not enough. I think it is on the GitHub of Yuval.
I haven't seen it.
I can double check it.
Sorry. So the KKT matrix comes from the LQR problem, is it? When you want to solve the LQR problem, we come up with this KKT matrix that
yes,
has to be.
Yes, well, that's one way of saying it. So the KKT matrix is something in solving a quadratic problem under linear constraints.
Yeah.
So I just take the shape of this particular problem and I put the equation of the classical KKT, and that's the shape you get for the LQR problem. So this is the KKT matrix for the LQR problem.
And you say that when you do DDP, basically what you do is equivalent to computing this KKT matrix in more efficient
so
ways.
In Crocodile, we have a KKT solver that we are using for unit tests. And we validate that for any problem you write, the KKT solver gives the equivalent solution to the DDP solver.
Okay. And the KKT solver is doing that by just inverting this matrix basically.
Yes.
To find the solution.
Yeah. Dense. So it's not for, it's not done for being unit.
I see.
It's done for unit tests.
Sorry. So what is the disadvantage of using sparse solver for this one?
It's difficult to implement.
It's difficult to implement.
So to go a little bit more in detail, when you want to compute the solution, so what you want is to get kx is equal to a. So in fact, you want k minus 1 times a. And you may want to compute k minus 1, but very likely what you want to do is to solve k minus 1 times a. For doing that, there is two main solutions.
Mm-hmm.
One is to decompose k into two matrices that are easy to solve.
Mm-hmm.
The other one is to go to an iterative solution,
mm-hmm.
like a gradient descent, that is approximating the inverse.
Mm-hmm.
For sparse solver, very often it's difficult to compute the sparse decomposition.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you take any random sparse matrix, the decomposition you take of it is not sparse
mm-hmm.
anymore. So you are breaking the so you need to do some smart stuff,
mm-hmm.
and there is not so good smart stuff available. So for sparse solver, you go with iterative approaches
okay.
that are approximating the solution. And that's what we are doing in the augmented Lagrangian.
Okay.
And that's not working.
Okay.
Because we are not strong enough. Strong people could do that.
Okay.
Okay, so for the class, there is two main examples that are the carpool tutorial and then the manipulator tutorial. The idea is to, through this example, introduce the API of Crocodile. What are the classes we implemented to model a problem, and how they are done. The idea with the carpool is that we give the skeleton. You have to implement the dynamics. So put the dynamics here. And then there is a skeleton for defining the carpool model. The carpool problem, and to solve the carpool problem with a nice video at the end as a reward. So the carpool, for those that are not, or not as
in my computer.
Yeah. So the carpool is a problem where you have a cart in one dimension, so it's moving on a rail. You can exert any forces you want on the cart. And on the cart, you have a pendulum that is underactuated, so it's moving only because of the acceleration of the cart. So with the acceleration of the cart, you can clearly swing the pendulum. And then you can swing them in a way that you are increasing its energy until finally it reaches the top position. The goal of the carpool problem is to raise the pole in a standing position and stabilize it there with the zero velocity. So the DDP solver is able to do that. And yeah, you have the skeleton to do that. It should not be too difficult. So that's for the carpool problem. We will spend half an hour on it. And then there is maybe 25 minutes on it. And then there is a manipulator problem. So the manipulator problem is digging a little bit further in the model class that we develop in Crocodile. So for the carpool, you are giving the derivative, the dynamics analytically. For the manipulator arms, we are using Pinocchio to compute the dynamics, solve the dynamics, compute the derivative of that. So everything is well implemented. You just load the Pinocchio model and it will give you everything. And here we give you an example where that's a peak task. So the arm has to go somewhere and reach an object. And we are guiding you to put four objects and ask to the system to go to each four objects in the sequence. So this second example is more to say, let's define a complex problem and play on how it's played. A last remark is, I had some questions about how Crocodile compared to HPP. They cannot be compared. HPP is a planner, so it's something that is sampling and that is searching for one solution, even if it's not a good solution. And then Crocodile is an optimizer. It's not able to discover a good solution, or barely able to discover a good solution. But if you give him a feasible solution, he's meant to make a nice solution out of that. In that sense, Crocodile is much better to compare with TSID. So if we are strong enough, the idea is that during the project we can replace TSID by Crocodile. So TSID is the state of the art now to control a robot, and we know that there is limits, in particular for locomotion. TSID is not able to trigger a step or stuff like that. DDP should be able to do that. Should be able to better capture the dynamics of the robot through the using the horizon. And there is many similarities between Crocodile and TSID. So like TSID, Crocodile is a collection or library of various tasks, cost, control, that you can put together with the dynamics model and well, shake it a little bit and it will give you a control. Okay. And in fact, in theory, if you take a Crocodile problem and you decrease the horizon until the moment where the horizon vanishes, then you get a TSID solution.
Basically, TSID don't optimize in time,
that's the thing. It's instantaneous optimization, yeah. So it's like taking the horizon and shortening it until it collapses. Yeah. And then that makes it linear, so it makes the problem much smaller because you don't have the horizon, and it makes the problem linear because you are collapsing the horizon.
Here, the optimization is in terms of time,
yeah.
TSID is instantaneous.
But, I mean, so comparison to say, TSID is a lot of cost, task, constraints, contact classes wrapped in a way you can use that in a QP solver. And then the QP solver it's not in a TSID, it's somewhere else. Crocodile it's very much the same. You have task, cost, contact, you can put them together and you give that to a solver. The solver is homemade, it's a DDP solver, but it's a very small part of it and it could be something else. So a lot of and the way task, cost, all that are defined is quite similar to the way the TSID is defining them. Since we are moving to the nonlinear part, there is not so much that we can reuse from TSID. And maybe that's a mistake, maybe there is more than what I believe. We could discuss that. But yeah, that's the idea. The idea is that with Crocodile, we would like in the project to build something as mature as TSID. TSID started something like 4 or 5 years ago. The Python version?
No, the C++ version 2 years ago.
Yeah, but the Python version?
Months ago.
No, the Python prototype. So
Python prototype.
You developed that when you arrived in LAS? Which
I developed that 5 times,
yeah.
About
8 years
ago.
So that's the same as the Crocodile. So we are, that's the fifth DDP that we have in the lab. And that's the prototype, and from this prototype we want to build a nice TSID
The main motivation of having DDP against TSID is momentum control, because you when you are moving, you have a lot of links, and you have these links represent if you conserve, you see the conservation momentum conservation. They represent no holonomic constraints, and by definition, non-holonomic system you should control with some kind of preview. So that's what the argument behind. Why we have to do some horizon in TSID? Why we need this method? That's the our main motivation. I think you didn't explain the differential atom model.
Let them work into it.
Okay. But I just want to say something. Differential atom model is in continuous time compared with the atom model that we used before, so that's why we need to use an integrate action model so to convert it to discrete time.
You can give the function that are computing not directly the next step, but the acceleration to go to the next step.
No.
And then there is an integrated action model that will do the integration scheme, so temporal integration. So we implemented implicit ELR and Runge-Kutta 4. That's the two basic ones that we have done. So here in the carpool, you are implementing the differential dynamics. So you are computing the acceleration as a function of state and control. And then we are using the implicit ELR to integrate us. So that's the basic class that you are using in this tutorial. So, as a question, who was able to do a simulation of the carpool? So, implement the equation and roll out, and see that the simulator is doing that.
The 1 point.
And trying to put that in the solver, was it working?
Okay.
You can put that on the board. So for those that are a bit lost, so what you have to do is inside the cal function that Nicola is playing is the one that is doing the rollout. You need to put your dynamic equation here inside this data container, and you have the equation here.
Some of them managed to do it.
But I have the
Jupiter. The Jupiter one?
Yes.
So,
yeah.
So that's the solution to the first question, implementing the dynamics. If you are lost and you don't understand the question, just copy that.
So inside the same folder, there is a carpool.py file. You can see there the implementation of the dynamics. And you can copy it in your Jupyter notebook and run it. So you have in your computer, you open the carpool.py file that is in the same folder, in the notebook folder, and inside there you will see the code for the differential equation. Is this file, and is this line of code.
The numerical answer you got. No, the numerical, when you actually simulate.
Sorry?
When you actually simulate, like, you get two numbers.
It's dot and theta, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah, scroll down.
You're
not in the notebook.
Put in your...
No, yeah, I was just trying to see I'm just trying to see whether the numbers I got that's correct.
You would have
just lazy.
Just go a little bit further, and you will have the display of the mission. You will feel if the physics is correct.
Okay.
And after that, it's another mathematical system that you discover.
Most likely, it's wrong. First time around.
With Umut, right?
With your virtual machine. I'm using your
there is other students that have the same problem in the back. And that's the geek of Edinburgh, so they will find a solution.
Okay.
Or implementing your own numerical differences. So you have two choices here. So in CycleDiff, you might implement your own derivative, but it's better that for this exercise, because we are learning, it's better to use the numerical differentiation tool. So once you have your carpool, your differential action model done, you can get the non-diff version of it. So this guy basically is filling the CalDiff code for you. He's doing these operations numerically.
Carpool and D, it's a vector of.
Carpool and D is a knot, it's an action model. An action model.
Yes.
Well, a differential action model, sorry. Differential action model.
So it's a class that has inside.
It's a class. And it's a class that has the same method that the differential action model. Compute for you the derivative. So, what you are doing in an action model? You have to implement your calc function, which computes the dynamics and the cost value, and a calc disk which computes the derivative for you. In this exercise, we are asking you just to work with calc function, and then we have a structure that compute calc disk for you using numerical differentiation. So we are not. You can feel it here.
So you have the same.
Your derivative, like, but you don't have to. Okay. It's better if you feel it because it's faster.
No. When you go to integrate the model.
Okay. So.
Because we need that. Here we want to use the.
So the integrator. The differential action model. Everything is continuous. You obviously need to discretize this. The solver uses discrete variables. Discrete time variables. So. You can do it automatically with integrate action Euler. So basically, that class implements symplectic Euler integration scheme. So it's called symplectic. It's called semi-implicit because we are doing one part implicit and one part explicit. So we are, in fact, the configuration when we integrate, we do implicitly, and the other implicitly. It conserves the geometry of your problem, but it doesn't matter. It's a kind of Euler integrator, and you for creating this integrate action class, you need to have your numerical differential class, and you need to define the time step. And this is actually the class that the DP
solver uses. Yeah, but what I mean is that it's already everything defined. We have the Carpool ND, we have the time step, so we don't need that.
Yes, we do.
Okay, check it, and I have to go to EU,
le derivate che le scrivi le derivate. Sì, derivate di frequenze.
Noi parliamo scritto di rompere, perché sono le equazioni dinamiche.
Ah, ok.
Poi lui qua, quello che fa è calcolare. Invece di fare le parti significa che ti le tue derivate, se ce l'hai. Se magari c'è un modello che non sai derivare, tu lo derivate e poi lui ti fa la integrazione numerica.
Le derivate, il problema è che se le scrivi male, cioè, quindi conviene.
Vabbè, se c'è un modello come quello stupido,
ma per fare la digressione numerica, tu per ogni variabile del tuo sistema devi fare due calcoli, cioè avanti e indietro e in un passo piccolo per fare la tangente, calcolare la tangente numerica. Quindi è veramente. Fai un sacco
di. So, apparently, on the virtual machine, there is. When you want to display the carpool, there is a problem, there is missing FFmpeg. It's installed. FFmpeg. Is that this one?
Right? Yes. EG.
So you need to and remember the password is I am a robot.
No space.
So for those that already look a little bit in the carpool, we're able to roll out to start the solver. Well, basically that's it. You are guided in the class about how to build the problem, and then the questions are about how to tune the problem so that you get a good solution. And here it's a terminal problem, so you want the beginning of the trajectory to help to reach a terminal state. So this delay problem are difficult to solve, and then you need to carefully tune the gains to get that.
I did not play a lot with this problem. We did that tonight. So I was easily able to set up a standing position. It was more difficult to nullify the velocity at the end of the interval. And for that, adjusting dynamically the gains was the easier solution. So that was the final step. So for those that,
what initial angle did you choose to?
Oh, I start from minus p. Yeah.
You can play with that.
I did not. So here I put an initial position so that the rollout would make this nice fall. That is very easy to see. Then I did not try to solve from this position. I solved from minus three. So I this one I don't know if it's the solver is able to get it or not. In the solution?
Yes, like in
the solution is wrong, you mean? The dynamics of
it's a residual vectors which you use to compute the cost.
Oh, okay.
So I think it should be 1 minus cosine.
No, the 0 is up.
It's tan.
Yeah, okay, but when theta is 0. The sign is 0, but
the cosine is 1. And you want to minimize that? Yes? Yeah, you're right.
But if you minimize the cost theta, it'll give you
1 minus cosine. Yeah, right.
Yes. And why is it working? That's first time.
Maybe just ignoring the
ghost term, but the sinus.
I mean, what way did you put on sine and cosine when?
I don't know. It is on the solution that you have.
You can
solution.
Maybe.
You can
all these.
I put a huge term in a both cos and sine, and it should get crazy.
Whatever the theta has, if you minimize the square of it will be always the same.
It's doing that, so it's basically it's working.
So what did you change?
So that's the solution that is in the carpool.pi in the same directory, same folder. And to get a nice convergence at the end, I put 10,000 as terminal cost for both the cos and sine.
Okay.
And as you say, the cost term is wrong.
Yeah.
So
I mean, just I guess they cancel out because it's cosine squared plus sine squared of the same amount. So,
so it should clearly not work.
The way, yeah. I mean, maybe the other cost terms are enough to get a good solution.
Yes, apparently yes. Solution is much better. So it was a mistake. I don't understand why it is working, and it's working better when the mistake is not there. Okay, so I will go quickly in the ideas of the next presentation of the next tutorial that we won't have time to achieve. Can you give me the slides again? So in this first tutorial, it's a very simple class that we introduced, so that's very standard API.
which means that if you want to develop your own problem with your own rigid body model or anything like that, well, you can use this basic API and you will still be able to get the solver DDP at the end. But then the interest of Crocodile is an implementation where we connect with Pinocchio. So first, when you connect with Pinocchio, very likely what you want to handle is a dynamic that is not Euclidean. So you have a quaternion somewhere on the free player, typically. And for that, we need to define a state model. So something that defines what is the dimension of the state, what is the dimension of the derivative of the state, so likely to be a little bit smaller than the derivation of the state, how you integrate, how you differentiate. Okay? You put all that in the state, and we have in particular a state Pinocchio that is implemented. You give a Pinocchio model, and you build you a state model for that. Then we have a specific implementation of the differential action model, the same you did for the carpool. We have one that is using a Pinocchio model inside, and then that is using an ABA algorithm to compute the direct dynamics or to do the simulation, and that is using the derivative of the ABA algorithm that is coded in Pinocchio. Okay? Then it makes something that is much faster to solve for the arm than it was for your pendulum. Okay? In fact, it's more difficult for you to solve the pendulum than it would be to solve the arm. In this differential action model, we decided to separate the cost model from there. So maybe for efficiency reason, at the end, we want to have a single differential action model that is really tuned for the application we have. But while we are searching for the good formulation of the problem, we say, well, we don't know if we want to put the cost on the center of mass, on the weight, on the foot, etc. So we let that open, and we create a cost model. So in each instance of the cost model, you have one particular cost function with this derivative. One of the particularities that there is no Pinocchio data inside. It is relying on the Pinocchio data that are in the differential action model, so that we don't redo all the forward kinematics or all this stuff. Everything is done once in the differential action model, and then the cost is just picking inside Pinocchio the right values and putting them in the matrix. The costs that we implemented so far are the ones that we are needing for the locomotion problem, that is frame placement, frame translation, so that's the 6D task and the 3D task, frame velocity, center of mass, cost on the state for regularization, cost on the control also for regularization, and so sum of cost. So if you want to have an action model where you have a little bit of placement of the foot, a little bit of the center of mass, and a little bit of a state, well, you put all that together, and it's making you one model. And also one cost for the joint limits that we are handling through penalty. So you are putting a cost term that is strong when you are close to violate the joint limit. Okay, so that is enough for the manipulation tutorial. If you are very motivated, you can keep working during the break, but we will stop now. So in the tutorial, I say it again. We give an example where the manipulator has to reach a terminal position, 3D. And we guide you to develop a gesture where it should go in a sequence to four key terminal positions. So we build a sequence of models that go to first position, then a sequence of models that go to second position, a sequence of models to the third position, a sequence of models to the fourth position. You concatenate all that. It makes you a long sequence. Now the sequence is time dependent, right? The first action models are not the same as the second action models. You give that to the DDP and it's optimized to have a nice and smooth way of going through the points. And for a very final presentation, what we have in addition to that is we are not only interested to have a cost for defining what how the model should work. We are also interested to have to have contacts. So we have introduced this. So working contacts means, first, the contact point should not move, so that's an additional constraint. In addition to the dynamics, you have the constraint that the contact point should not move. And in compensation for these constraints, you have forces that you can exploit in your system. Having constraints in the DDP is something difficult. That's one of the drawbacks of the DDP. I did not insist on that. DDP is a weak solver, and in addition to that, it's very difficult to put additional constraints inside the solver. So in order not to have the, to handle this constraint at the solver level, we put that in the dynamics. So that's a trick that was introduced by Todorov, and it's very handy. If you say to the dynamic engine, so the stuff that will do the integration, that there is a constraint, there is no movement that will go out of the simulator that does not respecting the constraint. So you say that the foot is fixed on the ground, the simulator will always keep the foot fixed on the ground. And then whatever the DDP wants to compute, the foot will stay fixed on the ground. So the DDP does not have to care for this constraint, that the simulator that is doing, that is taking care of this constraint. Okay? So that's the way we implemented it. So like for the manipulator, you have a dynamics of mass time acceleration plus the drift terms plus the torques, and you add this term of the forces, the contact forces, and it's coming with this constraint that the acceleration at the contact point should be zero. So this can be reformulated as a problem like this one. So you have M, J, T, and J, which will make this KKT matrix that we have to invert. We do all that during the simulation. So instead of running ABBA for computing the simulation, we compute all these terms and we invert the matrix, and that's the solution we get. We have the derivative of that. And all that is implementing is what we call the differential action model floating in contact, the DAMFIC. Well, it's the full name that you have in a crocodile. You have the, inside you have the cost model, you have contact model, so if you want to put 6D contact or 3D contact, it's implemented. If you want to implement other contact models like rolling contact, you can. And in addition to that, you also have to provide the actuation model, so because the floating system has no actuation of its base. Well, actually, we define a generic actuation model, so if you want to have strings or springs in your system, well, it can go there as well. It's pretty generic. You put all that, you get a differential model, you give that to the integrator, you get an action model, you give that to the shooting problem, you get a big shooting problem, you give that to the solver, and for that, with that, you can solve a locomotion problem. Yeah.
For that formulation, you still need that the velocity is zero when you make contact, right? So either as an impact law or...
Okay, yeah, there is a, yeah, so there is an impact law that I'm not mentioning here. So you are too fast for me, but yes. So either you say, you put a cost saying, just before contact I should have zero velocity, and you crank up the gain, so that it's really enforced. Or you put in your action models, one of the action models is impact model. The impact model will not change the configuration, it will just change the velocity. It will nullify the velocity in the contact, taking into account the mass for distributing that. And when you have that, you can put additional cost on how you want the impulse for the impact to be shared by the body. So yes, you can do that. And that's two ways that are working for the locomotion problem. I'm yet not sure what is the best one. So physically, the impact model is the best one. Numerically, or for going for the robot, we don't want impact. Either of both should give more or less the same solution, and numerically I'm not sure which one is the best. Investigating that, I think, is interesting. We are done for today. A little bit too long, I'm sorry for that. I think with not too many problems with the tutorials. I'm very interested to have feedback for this software. So once more, this is not a software that I'm trying to sell. It's really a development software. What I'm trying to buy is collaboration. So inside the project, I would like to gather attention to optimal control. It's really one of the duties we have in the project. We need to release something that looks like crocodile. It does not have to be crocodile. And I think it's a very hard task, so we should collaborate on that. Crocodile could be a basis for that, or it could be not. But for that, we need feedback. And I think it would be a very bad point that Cinerest is working alone on that, and at the end of the second period is providing a solver of the shape that then you will fight to apply on your robots during the third period. So we should anticipate and look at it, feedback, and then we decide. We do C++ code, we do something else, I don't know. Okay? Thank you very much for your attention.